Great to see you. Pastor Fran, welcome to Beacon Church. The Lord is so good. If you didn't get a chance to be in Sunday school, I was really blessed today. We had one of our best Sunday school classes that we've had since I've been here in my class. I pray that the others did well as well and had that interaction. If you're not a part of our Sunday school ministry at 9:30, let me invite you to one of our classes. We have four adult classes. We have classes for kids and teenagers as well. And we want to be sure that we offer that chance for people to grow in the Word. I use the words connect, grow, serve, go, and I mean that seriously. We connect with Christ and with one another, and we grow in the Word, and we serve Jesus any way that God has gifted us to do. And then we go on mission and give on mission. We're going to talk about that a little later on today as we talk about Operation Christmas Child and some of the other things. But I do want to welcome you. If you're a first-time guest, especially welcome. If you've never filled out one of our Connect cards, be sure that you do that and give it to me on your way out. I'd love to go ahead and pray for you if you have something for me to pray about. Grab your Bibles. Will you do that? Grab your Bibles and turn to Psalm 104. Psalm 104. Great passage to read. I read through the Bible every year. I think I've said this before. And as I'm reading through the Bible, I journal something that comes out of that. And this last week, I came across Psalm 104 in part of my readings. I'm reading an Old Testament and a Psalm, and a New Testament and a Psalm. It's a little different of a plan. And then, so I get to read the Psalms twice. So this is my second time through the Psalms. I'm in Psalm 104, and I'll probably read a little more of the Psalms by the time I get to the end of this one. But Psalm 104 is a wonderful, just a great way to start to worship together. So let's all stand together and honor God's Word, and let's praise the Lord together. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. He lays the beams of his chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes his messengers winds, his ministers. Hear this. His ministers, a flaming fire. He set the earth on its foundations. It could never be moved. You covered it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. At your rebuke, they fled. And the sound of the thunder, they took to flight. The mountains rose, the valleys sank down to the place you appointed for them, and you set a boundary they may not pass, so they might not again cover the earth. You make springs gush forth in the valleys. They flow between hills. They give drink to every beast of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. Beside them, the birds of the heavens dwell, and they sing among the branches. And from your lofty abode, you water the mountains. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of your work. Go down to verse 24. O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you've made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. The sea great and wide, which teems with creatures innumerable. Living things, both small and great. Verse 33. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Let sinners be consumed from the earth. Let the wicked be no more. Bless the Lord. Say it with me. Oh, my soul. Praise the Lord. Father, we praise you. You, God, created all things. By the word that you spoke, Christ, through him and in him, all things are created. All things are sustained. By the words that we read, Lord, we see how great you are. Father, I don't pray for gimmicks. I don't pray for momentum. I don't pray for anything fancy. I pray, God, that our hearts may just bless your name today. Let every word that we sing be from our heart, every thought that we have be all about you. Lord, bless the Lord, oh my soul. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing to the Lord.
Let's continue standing and worship.
Your grace is enough, heavenly cheer. You are my
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Can we do that? Praise God. Let's be seated. I just got to say, I'm so thankful for our praise team. Can we just say thank God?
Yeah.
Amen. I just love their heart. I love their giftedness. I love how God just uses them. And the Lord is so good, so good. If we have children that are getting ready to go to Beacon Kids, go ahead and meet them. Have them meet their teachers out in the foyer. We'll get started with that. We are in Mark chapter 6, and we're going to be in Mark this week, and we'll be moving ourselves back to studying through Mark in a few weeks. This week and next week wraps up our He Gets Us series as we think about how Jesus understands us, gets us, and calls us to something that glorifies His name. In a few weeks, and that's starting the 15th of October, we'll start a new series called He Changes Us. You see what I did there? Right? So, He Changes Us. And we'll look at the book of Mark, how Jesus calls us to be different and to be changed in Him, to do something incredible that glorifies Him. But this week is a topic that a lot of us struggle with. Years ago, I had a business. I'm one of those guys that have done a bunch of different jobs throughout his life. I just couldn't hold down a job, I guess. I don't know. But years ago, I had a cleaning company where we cleaned on the weekends, timeshare, and during the week, janitor supplies. So, selling brooms, I actually had a broom company, mops, chemicals, toilet paper. You know, a few years ago, you would have loved a guy like me, right? COVID. It was great. I fed my family of four kids and a wife and a family of six. I was able to do ministry. I was able to begin to go to school. Eventually, I couldn't do it all, and I sold off the business and took a step of faith and fully trusted in the Lord. But while I was still dependent on that income, I was a one-man show. I'm going somewhere, so just stay with me. I would go to the customer, and I would start new customers. I'd give them a price list. I would talk to them about what I could offer. And this is in Daytona Beach, Central Florida, Orlando. And so there's a lot of hotels, there's a lot of apartments, there's a lot of competition, but a lot of those contacts that you can make. And I would get new customers, and I would do this. I was a one-man show. I would take their order. I would, at that afternoon on a Monday, I would take their order. On Monday night, I would put in my order to my wholesale supplier, who would then the next day or the day after deliver it to me. I would put it on my truck, and I would deliver it to the customer. And I just kept doing that over and over again. And the bills were paid, and I was able to take care of my family that way. And it was a great gig for a while. Okay, God really gave me that opportunity to pay for my the family's needs, take care of my family's needs, and God gave it to us. But here's something that happened that scared me ever since. I was across the street from the warehouse that I had rented, and it was a busy intersection, and I had to park across the street from my warehouse at the time because I needed to go in to speak to somebody in the warehouse office who managed all the warehouses. And so I parked my truck with the trailer along the side of the road, and I had to cross this busy street. It was an access road, and I had to cross the street, and there was a truck that was in front, that was right behind me where I parked my truck, and there was a truck in front. So somehow I parallel parked that. Don't ask me how, I was really good with that. But I was able to do that. And without thinking about it, I began to walk into the street. And the truck that was blocking my view was, you know, I couldn't see what was going on. And I began to walk, and something told me at the last second, stop. Just then a UPS truck zoomed down the road. And I mean, within a split second, it zoomed in front of me. And I felt the breeze and was kind of thrown back from that. Ladies and gentlemen, I should have died that day. With a wife and four kids, a business that was dependent on me, and a future that I felt that was heading to serve the Lord, I should have died this day. But something in me, if you want to say the Holy Spirit, if you want to say it was an angel, but something stopped me from taking that step. And during that time, I had a fear that what if something happened to me? Would my family be okay? And that drove a lot of things. And so my fear was there. You might have other fears. You might have a fear that is your spouse taken care of, or is your family taken care of? Or maybe you have a fear of crime. Or maybe you have a fear of politics, of a foreign invader. Maybe you have a fear of a diagnosis. Maybe you have a fear of the dark, or a fear of people, being around people, or a fear of being in crowds, or a fear of being in intimate settings. We all have fears of some sort. Jesus and his disciples give us a great illustration for fear and how to overcome it. Jesus simply says to them in the passage we're going to read, to take heart, do not fear. Basically, he says, look, the three things he says to them when we look at the verses here, and I'm in Matthew, I need to be in Mark, duh. I'm like, this doesn't match. Jesus says very simply to them as we get to the words he says in verse number 50, take heart, it is I, do not fear. And that's easy to say. I have, of course, I mentioned four adult kids when they were younger. I had several of them were scared of the dark. You ever have children who are scared of the dark, right? Or maybe some of you are, right? And they would find ways to bug you. They're supposed to go to sleep. And our kids, we put them to sleep at 8:30 at night. I'm telling you, we were tough. You know, the kids would go to sleep and they would be like, it's still light outside, go to sleep, right? And so they would try to find ways to get up. I'm thirsty, I need to use the bathroom. Amen? Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? And one of them was so afraid, he was afraid of the dark and he was afraid of monsters, right? So he decided he would bring his youngest one, which we didn't appreciate, the youngest one, who was nine years younger than him, around to the other parts of the house and send him in front of him. And I guess he was sending him as bait in his mind. I don't know. But he would do that and he would be afraid. And our response would be something really tough, really harsh. You know, stop it. Go to bed. Would you stop doing that, right? Jesus does something different than what we would have done or what we did. Jesus said, take heart. Be encouraged. I love you. It is I, do not fear. The disciples are on a boat in the Sea of Galilee, and we're going to see that in a minute. And Jesus and them are with the crowds, and then Jesus goes up to pray. And the disciples, he says, get on a boat and go to the other side. And so they just obeyed him without question. Well, good for them. But they were struggling. These disciples were struggling in this boat. Now, most of them are professional fishermen, right? They know a few things about a boat. And yet they're struggling. Again, we have other recordings where they're struggling. The winds, it says in the text, if you look at chapter 6 of the book of Mark, the winds are pressing against them. And as we look at this and start at verse 45 and verse 48, it actually says they were making headway, the ESV says, painfully. They're trying to cross the water painfully. And so here they are trying to make it, and the wind is against them. And they struggle. So let's take a look at the word here. Let's take a look at the text. I want to read the text, and then I'll expand on it in a minute as we start to get into our outline. If you look in your Bibles, you've got your Bibles open, I really want you to... There's a reason why, church, I don't put the words up on a screen. You know why? Because some of y'all won't use your Bibles, right? Why would you? It's up there, right? Or you won't use your phone. So take your Bibles, whether it's in electronic form or the old-fashioned paper form, right? Take your Bibles. Let's look at Mark 6, starting with verse 45. Let's stand in honor of God's Word. Immediately he is Jesus, made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had taken leave of them, he went up on a mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. Now here it is. And he saw they were making headway, what is that word? Painfully, if you got the ESV, for the wind was against them. In about the fourth watch of the night, I'll explain in a minute, he came to them walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost. And they cried out, for all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased, and they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. Let me keep going. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countryside, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. Father, we praise you for the God-breathed, Spirit-infused word that is inerrant, infallible, and incorruptible. We, Lord, place it in authority to teach us, to guide us, to direct us, and to convict us. Lord, convict the preacher and those being preached. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated. So they're struggling. They're in a boat. They're in the middle of this lake. By the way, the Sea of Galilee, Lake Gennesaret, it was about, in most places, about 8 miles across, 6 to 8 miles across. They were, it says, we see from the texts, that they were pretty much all night and had gone about 3 to 4 miles. So ladies and gentlemen, they were halfway across the lake, and they had been sailing all night. And in this text, if you look at it, it said that they were there, and they left in the evening, and that at the fourth watch, in verse 48, at the fourth watch of the night, that's about between 3 and 6 a.m., before the sun came up, they were halfway across the lake. They had been sailing for 6 to 8 hours, and they only made it that far. They were struggling. They were exhausted. They were struggling. And the book of John gives us some clarity in the same text. It says it was 3 to 4 miles. That's it. That's all they went. And so that's all they got accomplished. And so they're tired. They're exhausted. And they see a sight in the distance. Now you imagine you're struggling and you're scared because of winds and waves and all this stuff, and it's a fierce lake to be on. And I'm sure when Jesus said, hey, get in the boat, they were like, ah, right? And Jesus, they see in a distance something walking towards them. And immediately, being tired and being even in a superstitious kind of age, it says they cried out because they thought it was a ghost. They thought the sight of Jesus or whatever it was a ghost. Literally, in the text, they thought it was a water spirit. Sounds like some of the tales of sailors, right? They thought it was a water spirit, and why would they think that? Well, the world had not left their mindsets. The culture had still been around them. They heard all these stories all their lives, and here's a water spirit that's coming towards them. Oh, no, you know, what are we going to do? And so they got these spirits or ghosts or whatever, and so they were just crying out, scared, terrified, it says. Look at verse 49. When they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost, and they cried out, verse 50, for they all saw him and were terrified. Look, whether it's tired or whatever it is, we all have our own fears. We're going to get into the outline in a minute. But as ridiculous as it sounds for disciples to believe in ghosts or water spirits, we have our own very crazy fears. If you have not heard the news, and it has been debunked, the Mexican Congress had in front of them video where they had a hearing on UFOs. Our own Congress did that, but the Mexican Congress one-upped them. Just like our own Congress had a hearing on UFOs, they did one better, and they actually displayed what they called two ancient aliens in coffins on the floor of the Mexican Congress. How many of y'all saw pictures of that? Yeah, right? What do you think about that? Crazy, right? And what did these aliens look like? They looked like E.T. Imagine that. I don't know about you, but that seems like an incredible coincidence that these 1,000-year-old supposed aliens resembled E.T. in size and stature. And you're laughing about it, but people were actually scared about it. Like it was some new revelation. Oh no, what does that do, right? People believe it though. And it's a hoax. It was debunked. Or at very best a misinterpretation by some well-meaning people, but of something they dug up. But people have fears that sometimes we can laugh at. So don't laugh at the disciples who had these fears. Understand that that's exactly what fears do. They make us think of really weird things. So we're going to look at the text. Because Jesus handled their fears in a very Jesus way. And what can we learn from that for our own fears in our lives? And I don't want you to dismiss fears. I want you to face your fears. Amen? And so there's a few things I want you to look at as we go through our outline. And you've taken notes either in the handout or in the booklet or online or whatever, in the Bible app. I want you to look at your outline because I want you to understand there are two main types of fears. It's going to be up there behind me. That we need to consider. What is the source of our fears, right? We need to settle that. The first source that we have is often external threats. A lot of times we can group them as external threats. I had a fear of getting hit by a truck after I almost got hit by a truck, right? Kids have a fear of the dark, right? And then there's some internal stuff that happens. You know, we get these external fears, and really, I'm going to group them in two categories. One is in external fear threats is Satan's attacks. Satan's attacks. Now, if you've got your Bibles, I want you to do this. I'm going to have you turn to John chapter 6. Okay, John chapter 6. And you can mark your page, this page later on if you'd like. But if you go to John chapter 6 and you look at verse 15, leading into the parallel story to the Mark passage that we've been studying. You're going to go back to Mark in a minute. But John 15, look at the reasoning why Jesus and the disciples left the area. You see it? I'm going to read it. Perceiving then that they, meaning the people, were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. Satan wants the people to take and make a secular king out of Jesus. He has been doing that. We have seen all other attempts. Even some of the disciples thought that was going to happen. When we see the the temptation to rely on your own power, that is from Satan. David did this when he took a census of Israel, as Satan led him to do that. He was relying on his own power instead of God's powers. Satan will cause us to do things like this. And the first type of external threat then, of course, is Satan's attacks. The whole reason why the disciples and Jesus left the area was because the people were trying to force him to be their king, to conquer the Romans, right? That's not God's will. And when it's not God's will, it's man's will. And if man's will conflicts with God's will, it's complete disobedience. God's will was that Jesus would go to the cross, that he would become a suffering servant that we see in Isaiah 53, not this conquering king that we will see one day when Jesus will come riding on a horse with a sword at his side, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's not happening yet. So where do we get this idea of disobedience? If you go all the way back to Satan in the Garden of Eden, we see that Satan tempted people to disobey even then. He went in the Garden of Eden and he tempted Adam and Eve to disobey God. Why? So they could have knowledge of good and evil, that they will be like gods. Power. Corruption. Independence from God. To rule your own self. The American dream today is to rule yourself, to form your own things. My American dream was my own business with a great empire, right? It's not what Jesus has, though. Jesus didn't have us to be great conquerors. We're going to be more than conquerors. We're going to be followers of Christ who obey Christ. Now, Satan attacks us in a variety of ways today. He attacks you in your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. He attacks you in your body. He attacks you in your mind and thoughts. He attacks you in your soul. He attacks you in your heart. He discourages you. And he attacks all those domains because he wants you to be frustrated, to give up, or just to be complacent. How many of y'all have ever seen an animation movie from DreamWorks called Ants? Y'all ever seen that? Some of you have seen it. Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. It's a great movie. It's an older movie. It's a great movie. And it's an animated, one of those 3D animation movies. And it's about the ants who have to offer food to the evil grasshoppers. Right? And these grasshoppers are it would be like me against the wall, okay? And the grasshopper's super tall and I'm super small. And so because they were scared of what the grasshoppers might do, they worked really hard to get all the food for those grasshoppers, and then they would end up having just a little bit or even starving themselves, have very little for themselves. And when things got messed up in the movie and their food got ruined, they had to face the grasshoppers who wanted to stop them and be bullies to them. And so they were to come back and they were going to get their food. And I'll give you a spoiler, ants win in the end. They realize that those grasshoppers are bigger than they really are. Amen? And there is more ants than there were grasshoppers. And they end up winning, right? See, Satan uses fear to paralyze you. He intimidates you. He tries to intimidate you. Teresa and I were watching a game last night, go Reds, and the Mets were playing, and one of the players on the Mets had, you know, they have the dark stuff on their eyes, right? One of the players had a couple of crosses from the Mets, right? A couple of crosses on there, and Teresa said, and the good question, said, why does he have that? And I said, well, probably because he must be a Christian. I didn't know, but he must be a Christian, you know. And she said, rightfully so. I thought maybe he was using it to intimidate them. Amen. People do that all the time. They try to intimidate people. Some of these people get tattoos all over their face and head and neck and trying to intimidate. Listen, you want to get a tattoo on your face, go for it. Okay. Whatever. But what I'm saying is a lot of times people will do that to intimidate other people. Satan is trying to intimidate you with things in your life that frustrate you. And if you rest in your own chair, your own power, and I'm preaching to myself, if you rest in your own power and not in God's power, he's going to get you every time. So the external threats is one way through Satan that he does to understand, that you can understand fear with. The second fear, the type of fear, it's more internal that God affects you with, but it troubles you. But this comes not just from Satan, but from the world. It's the world's troubles. It's living, church. Listen, it's living in a fallen world. Did you know that we're in a broken world? I had a conversation with someone who said, you know, and I talked about how our world is broken, how our world is fallen. And this person said, this world is not broken. God loves us all. True, but our world is broken. You have to see that our world is broken. We've got broken politics and broken bodies and broken relationships and broken mindsets and broken worldviews. We have brokenness all around us. We all struggle with life. I struggle with life. You struggle with life. You may have had a diagnosis or maybe you received bad news about your work, or you maybe struggle because you have a loved one in your family that you don't talk to or you struggle with. Whatever. Or you might have trouble in your life. Jesus really has illustrated that we're going to have trouble. But when we do have trouble, Jesus said in John 14, look, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. And we see this illustration here in Mark chapter 6. So go back to Mark 6, because the disciples are on the Sea of Galilee, which is basically like a big ocean in a way, like a great lake. And they're in this boat, and they're struggling. They're struggling with this massive wind. They're literally going against the wind. And if you know anything about sailing, how many of y'all ever sailed in a sailboat? Yeah. You have to go along the side of the wind. If the wind is blowing this way, you have to use that wind to push you, and you go side to side. They call it tacking. You go side to side until you can catch the wind and go in the direction you want to go. And they're struggling with this massive wind. They've got the waves and the wind going at them, and they're troubled, and they don't know if they're going to survive this. And Jesus is nowhere to be found at that point. And their fears are really struggling with, they're struggling with. And so this external fears of the wind and the waves is really biting at them. And it begins to change the second source of their fears and feed into it. And that's internal thinking. You got external threats and you got internal thinking. And so here's what happens when you encounter internal thinking, because of the external things. First, we're physically tired. If you're physically tired, you start to succumb to fears in your thinking. The disciples are in the middle of the lake. They've been sailing for 6, 7, 8, 9 hours. You know, we worry about exactness of Scripture. Did you think about that before? That says about this hour or about this watch. When they said Jesus died about the 9th hour, we said, well, what time? What time was it? They didn't have these things. They didn't have these things. It was about this time. It was a culture that was not chronos, not exact. It was kairos. It was an age. It was about. It was an approximation. And so when they would talk about hours of the day or weights or things like that, it was generally in general terms. Yeah. It was an approximation. It was, don't worry about that detail. The detail is a point of the story. And so here they are. They've been sailing for 6 to 9 hours in very rough seas. It's the middle of the night, and they're physically drained. Now, if you've ever been on a boat, in a small boat, in very rough seas, it is a scary time. When I was a teenager, my friend decided, his father decided, and my friend invited me to go deep sea fishing with them. Now, I can do cruise ships. I love cruising. Woo! Yeah. But a little ship, and we're in the Gulf of Mexico, not Gulf of Mexico, the Gulf Stream, the off the coast of Florida and the Atlantic, and we're doing this. And let me tell you something. This is down in the Keys, off the Keys, off of Key Largo. We're doing this, and I started turning green. and I just got sick. He was fishing and I got sick. Gross. But what I'm saying is, you know, they are physically drained. They're exhausted. They're getting tossed around like rag dolls. You ever been tired being up all night, or been tired because you've been in an activity? And when you get tired physically, you get very emotional about things. You begin to think things. You begin to think thoughts and say things to in your mind and in your heart that may not really be true, but in your mind at that time it is true. And you get exhausted and you get emotional and fear takes over. Another part of internal thinking is that we begin to follow, another trait is we begin to follow the herd. We begin to follow the herd. Let me explain what that means. Sometimes people feel a certain way. You might be in a crowd of people or in a group of people, and one person feels that way, and everybody else follows the herd. Right? It's like the wave in a stadium. You know, ever been to a football game where they do the wave, and people are sitting, right? They're sitting, and you see the wave coming. You see the wave coming. And if you're one of those people that I shall not be moved, well, good for you. Right? But if they are coming around, woo! And then like that again, right? I personally find it's fun, but I find it distracting. I'm trying to watch what's going on, right? But they do in the wave, and they do in different ways. And sometimes I've seen these stadiums where they got the wave on the top row and a wave on the bottom row, and they're going different ways. Kind of cool, right? That's the illustration of following the herd. You get in a group, and you start getting groupthink. People feel a certain way, and it spreads to others, say, yeah, 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 and all of a sudden, everybody, quote unquote, feels that same way. Groupthink can really be contagious, but often it's not based on truth. It can happen in a positive way. A sports team can say, yeah, we're America's team. They should have never said that. We're America's team, right? And you start to have camaraderie, and you have a culture in a sports team, in a clubhouse, or in a locker room in football. You overcome certain things. See, you change. The culture is a good thing. Not my favorite guy, but let me give you an example of Deion Sanders. These days they call him Coach Prime. How many of you have ever heard of Deion, right? Neon Deion. Well, they call him Coach Prime now. He is the head coach now of the University of Colorado Buffaloes, the football team. Now, not counting COVID, the COVID year, the University of Colorado, which was at one time a premier team, okay? Top team, college football team in the country, one of the top. For 9 of the last 10 years, other than COVID, they have losing seasons. And I don't mean just a little losses. Last year they went 1-11. One win, 11 losses. That's one win the whole season. Losing was in their culture. So here's Coach Prime, Deion Sanders. He comes in there, and the first thing he does when he became the head coach is he let all the players know. He said, you haven't been doing the job, so you're going to probably get replaced. They weren't doing their job. The groupthink that they had was toxic to winning. They thought they couldn't do anything. And so he encouraged them. He said, listen, you're probably not going to play, so you might as well get in the transfer portal and go somewhere else. People are like, oh, how dare he do that? Maybe so. Of the 60 players on the roster of the University of Colorado Buffalo's roster, 60 players are on scholarship, only 20 were left. 40 of them had left to go to other colleges. Now, you may not like how he did it. You may not like what he did or how he said it. But guess what? Colorado has now won 3 games, and they're undefeated. They've won 3 times as many games now that they did last year, and it's only week 3. See, sometimes negative emotions like fear or down in the mouth kind of syndrome, it can be contagious and people start feeling a certain way. And this is exactly what we're seeing here with the disciples. They're in a boat, they're physically exhausted, and one sees a ghost, and so it cleanses a ghost, and it spreads. And in verse 50 it says, they all saw him, and they were terrified. Oh, look, a ghost! We follow the herd. So when we're physically tired and we let that little spark that gets the fear and our internal thinking going, we could be emotionally exhausted. And that's the third attribute of internal thinking. We're emotionally exhausted. And the physical affects emotional. I already said that. So people get angry about, you know, various things because they're tired. And when people get angry, sometimes we say, oh, that person's just tired, or they're sick, or they're sick and tired. Right? Somebody who's encountered a long illness can be tired or depressed or sad, and I get that. We understand that the physical affects the emotional. We understand that people react emotionally in a way because they're physically tired. Negative way, because they're tired. Now place yourself in a disciple's sandals for a minute, okay? They're in the Sea of Galilee. They've been in a boat for what seems to be an eternity. They're exhausted because it's the middle of the night. It's 3, 4, 5, 6 in the morning. The waves have not quit. The wind has not stilled. It's howling. And they've only got halfway across the sea. And they know people have died in this lake. They're emotionally exhausted. And their fear took over. And one person feels a certain way and it takes over the boats. They were literally, listen, in the same boat together. So what did Jesus do? What do we do? What do you do? What do you do when you feel fear? Here's what it is. I'm going to have it in your outline in a minute. The first thing is, listen to God speak. When you are struggling with a fear that you have over something, it might be a diagnosis, it might be a job loss, it might be a problem financially, it might be a problem with someone else, it might be an intimidation from something, whatever it is, listen to God speak. In verse 50, Jesus says these words that I emphasized at the beginning of the message that I want to emphasize here because this is a central piece of this entire text. Look at it. Y'all got your Bibles open? Say, okay, so we look at it and we see what Jesus says. Jesus immediately spoke to them and said, take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid. That's Jesus' immediate reaction, immediate statement. He says it to them. His initial immediate reaction to them was to give them words of calmness. But they weren't just words of calmness. They were words of who he was. When we look at what Jesus said here, he uses the Greek words, and I don't expect you to know Greek. It's all Greek to many of us, right? But he used the words, ego ami, meaning I am. We translate it and say it is I. But the Greek says, I am. Take heart, I am. Do not fear. Do not be afraid. Brothers and sisters, that is the same phrase that Jesus uses when Moses spoke to God in Exodus 3 when he said, who do I need to tell them that your name is? And he said, tell them that I am has sent you. He is saying, don't be afraid of the wind and the waves. Take heart. I am the God who created these things. I am here. Do not fear. There's no water spirit here. The God of the universe is standing before you. John Newton wrote the hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. And many of you know that John Newton was a captain of a slave ship. He had actually invested in the slave trade. And historians tell us that at the age of 23, Newton had had been on an English ship. He wasn't in charge of it, but he was on a ship. And he woke up to find out that the ship was off the coast of Ireland in a severe storm, and it was about to sink. So Newton, who was a heathen, who had rebelled against God, prayed to God at that point in his life to have mercy on him, and the storm died down. By the time Newton reached England, he became a Christian. He renounced his former profession, and he became an active abolitionist who spoke against the evil of slavery in England. Newton would later pen the famous words that we love to sing, and many of us know so well, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see." Hear this. "'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear God, and grace my fears of man relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed." When you're struggling, God is right here. Listen to him speak. Read his word. Listen to him. Here's the second thing you need to do when you feel fear. Is you choose faith over fear. Choose faith over fear. And that's your next outline. I'm going to have you turn to Matthew chapter 14. This is another parallel passage to this one in Mark. And it's interesting how they view it from different perspectives. It's the same truth. They see it in different ways. In Matthew chapter 14, looking at verse 28, we see something that happens in Matthew's account that we don't see in Mark or in John, and it is the account of Peter also walking on water. In this account, it gives us a little more detail than what Mark gives us. It says that Peter responded to Jesus once Jesus told him, "Take heart, I am, do not fear." Peter responded to him. Well, we know what he did. He stepped out of the boat, but first he spoke to him. He said, "Lord, if it is you, if you are the I am, then command me to come to you on the boat," on the water, rather. And Jesus spoke to him, and Jesus said, "Come, come on." Peter got out of the boat. He walked on water with Jesus. If you go to chapter 14, in verse 29, it says, "He said, come." Peter got out of the boat, walked on the water, and came to Jesus. And I don't know about you, but I've never heard of anybody walking on water besides Jesus, and now Peter. So think for a minute. Peter had never seen anyone before walking on the waves of water that are now calm, by the way, but once Jesus said who he was. And Peter believed Jesus so much, he was willing to take confidence that Jesus, with Jesus, he could even do that as well. Church, that's faith. He is choosing faith over his fear in this case. And let me tell you, if God is telling you to do something in your life, and you know it's truly of God, then choose faith over fear. I was perfectly comfortable in a cushy, and I mean cushy, denominational job, serving 1,000 churches in the state of Illinois. I was comfortable doing that. Teresa was comfortable doing it. The problem was, we weren't listening to what God wanted for us. God was very clearly bringing me back to the church. And I believe overwhelmingly that God called me here and Teresa here. And I have no doubt that I'm exactly where God wants me. Praise God. Was it scary to move for the fourth time in 4 years? Yeah. It's awful. Amen. But I believe we chose well. We chose faith over fear. It didn't make sense to my friends. It didn't make sense to secular people. Why would you do that? Well, you do it because God calls you. I've lived in Florida most of my life until I was 35, and I went to seminary, and I went to seminary, and we moved from Florida. I never went back other than vacations. I see my mom once in a while. People ask me, "You grew up in Florida, and you're in Cincinnati? How does that work? God? You choose faith over fear. It's a marker in my life and in my wife's life that God called us here. One of the songs that really I listened to that by Andrew Peterson was Canaan Bound. And if you don't know the song, it's okay. Not many people have heard it. But look at the words of Canaan Bound. You can look at it one day if you want. And it really is a call that Abraham had to go to a land, to go and see Hebron's Hills. In the house that we have in Sailor Park, I look across the river and I see Hebron's Hills. Hebron, Kentucky. But it's Hebron's Hills. But let me tell you, God spoke. Choose faith over fears. Choose faith over fear. If God is calling you to do something and it's confirmed in His Word and it's confirmed with godly people and it's affirmed and you know that the Spirit is calling you to do it, don't resist. Choose faith over fear. God will surely walk with you. Amen. Stay focused on Him is the next thing to do when you feel fear. You see, Peter's out on the water. He's walking on water. He's coming to see Jesus. And, well, something else happens. You see, verse 30 tells us, when he saw the wind, he was afraid. I think he got afraid of that. And he began to look at the wind and look at the waters. And, oh, by the way, I was mistaken earlier. The wind ceased after this point. It was still blowing. The winds were still going. And Jesus was with Peter, but then Peter began to look at the temptations and the worries of the wind and the waves and the stuff around him and took his eyes off Jesus, and he began to sink. And Jesus, he called out to him, "Lord, save me." And Jesus took his hand, he grabbed him, and he scolded him a little bit, and he saved him. Church, don't let side issues distract you if God has called you to do it. Don't get distracted from doing what's right just because the wind and the waves are tough. Peter got scared because of the wind and the waves that are around him. Maybe you have things around you that are bothering you. Get your eyes off of that and keep your eyes on Jesus. And when Peter took his eyes off Christ and back on Him, he gave us an illustration that we even know today. Stay focused on Him. Fear, external threats, internal thinking can cause you to do that. Jesus is near. 1 John 4:18 says there's no fear in love because perfect love casts out fear. Romans chapter 8, verse 14 through 17 says, "All you who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. You did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit. We're children of God. And if children, we are heirs, and the heirs of God and fellow heirs of Christ, provided we suffer with Him to be glorified with Him." And then later on in 8 of Romans 8, Paul says, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? It is written, for your sake we're being killed all day long. We're regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. And all these things," he says, "we are," what? "More than conquerors through Him who loved us." And then Paul says this, "For I am sure that neither death nor life, angels nor rulers, things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." If we get to the end of this account here as we're reading this, listen, we need to know that when Jesus was with them and He said, "Take heart, I am, do not fear, come out and walk," And he takes Peter's hand, and the winds calm down. We see something else that happened after that. See, if you are feeling fear, you want to listen to God, you want to choose faith over fear, you want to stay focused on Him. But the last thing is, trust God's will and get busy, church. Trust His will and His way. You see, they learned a lesson. And it's a lesson for us too. When we struggle in life, when we fear, know that Jesus is greater and that Jesus took them through the storm. And in that case, He'll take you through the storms today. He had a love for them that overcame their fear. Trust God's will and trust His way. And be encouraged by that. Be strengthened by that. You're struggling with something? Let God direct you. He will answer you. Maybe not now. Maybe in the future. We studied Daniel in Sunday school. And it was about Daniel saying, telling Belshazzar the interpretation of the hand that was writing on the wall. And before he even interpreted what it was, he told Belshazzar how evil and horrible he is. He could have gotten killed for that. He didn't care. He was going to say what he was going to say, and he was going to trust that God was protecting him, and he kept his integrity as he spoke boldly, and he told him about himself. Now, you may not be as dramatic as Daniel was, but if God's calling you to do something, and you're trusting in Jesus, and you're staying, you're choosing faith over fear, and you're staying focused on Him, then trust God for the outcome. The outcome doesn't matter immediately. What matters is in the end. I may never see the fruit of people I share my faith with, that they'll come to know Jesus, but maybe they'll come to know Jesus down the road. I'm one of those guys. I had people witnessing to me all over the place, and I just ignored them. Later on, all of that came together to lead me to Christ. Maybe you're struggling with something going on in your life. Maybe, again, it's a job or a diagnosis or a housing issue or something else. Maybe there's a family issue. Listen, if you trust God's will and way, God will be glorified and His will be honored. Maybe it will not work out for your good, but we know it will work out for the good for people who love Him, who are called according to His purpose. Trust God's will and God's ways. Listen to God speak. Choose faith over fear. Stay focused on Him and trust His will and His way. Father, I pray that my brothers and sisters, if they encounter fear, will have a guide to run to Your word. Lord, I pray for each person to be in Your word each day. Whether they read a paragraph or a book, Father, just speak to them through Your word. We know Your word is truth. We know Your spirit has breathed into it. And we know all authority rests in it. Because, Lord, it points to Jesus, who is Himself the divine revelation of Scripture. Father, I want to pray for that person who is struggling right now with something going on in their life. Decision, sickness, worry and fear about whatever it is that's in life. Because life is broken. The world is broken. And God, we look forward to the day when it won't be broken, when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And Father, for that individual who needs to follow You and trust You, I pray that if they don't know if they die today, they'd go to heaven, that You speak to them to make today the day of their salvation, to come forward, to respond to Your word, to find out what it means to trust Jesus. Pray for those here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 We're going to sing, and if God is speaking to you in some way, you need to pray for something that you're struggling with. You need to pray for a friend or a family. You need to become a member of this church. You come forward. We'll talk about it. Have you filled something out? We'll talk more. We do have Beacon 101. That will be in an announcement in a little bit. But I want you to let God speak to you. I want our church to be a church that responds to the word. Not to the pastor, but to the word. If God is speaking to you and you need to pray for someone or something, put feet, hear this, put feet to your decision, to your faith, so that God will solidify that as you have brothers and sisters praying for you as well. Amen. Let's sing together. Let's all stand, and I'll be here. My microphone will be off, and we can talk a little bit about it as we sing. What a song. What a song. To your eyes, the Lord a hand for that song. Amen. Amen. You can go ahead and be seated for a minute. I've got some announcements I'd like to share. Go ahead and put them on up, brother. You're going to have to leave me on these. I don't remember the order that they're in. Oh, yeah, the chairs. This comes in a minute. So these chairs, we are up to $1,000, I believe, is where we're at. Is that? Woo-hoo. Yeah, take a look at your bulletins there. $1,000, come on. Woo-hoo, it's okay. Yeah. So we are really, really close. We want to be around 60 chairs at least or more. And so if you haven't given online or in our Dropbox, make sure you put chairs on it. There is a category in giving online that you just have to select chairs. So it's there for you. And of course, that's as always a contribution, so it's tax deductible. So sponsor a chair, we want to get there. Okay, if you are considering becoming a member or you want to find out more about us, where we're heading, where our mission is, what our vision is, Beacon 101 is coming next month. It's coming October 15th after the service. There's going to be food. We like food. I like food. You all like food. And so if you are, if you're a current member, you just want to find out more, come and talk to me. And if we got room, I'll fit you in. If you're already a member, it's okay. You don't have to be a non-member or someone who is considering it or a new member. But we want to make sure that we have this chance for people to find out more about us. So praise God for that. Now, the next one is Candy Palooza. Can you say that with me? Candy Palooza. That's right. And so this is a community event. It's going to involve you setting up your trunks. Okay, I know we called it something else. We're not calling it that. We're calling it Candy what? Palooza. That's right. And so you're going to decorate your trunks, your cars. Set up games if you'd like to do a game. You don't have to, but if you just want to have your trunk set up with a fun, festive party atmosphere, nothing scary and spooky. Come on now, right? We are a church, right? Amen? But we want to pass out candy to the kids. You know, they love candy. I love candy. How many of y'all love candy, right? Candy doesn't love me, but I love candy. So let's be ready to do that. We're going to need volunteers. Sign up will go out next week for you to sign up for that. And if you have candy that you want to buy, if you're buying candy for next month, start buying candy. Bring in that candy. We'll make sure we have a box starting next week as well. This is a chance for you to do some outreach in an event. And our team and I haven't gotten together, but we'll get there, okay? The Planning Center app with a bunch of guys looking on their phones, right? Look, the Planning Center app is really powerful in terms of finding the calendar. The calendar's on there. It's there's a directory on there. There's our teams are on there. There's also giving online. And now we just did for the first time, we're doing a training in November for deacons. And I've opened this up to other churches. And we're actually using that app for people to be able to register for those things. It's kind of cool, right? So this app is low cost or free to us. Praise God for that. And there's the app. If you're not on it, be there or be square, okay? I know some of you are going to say, be square. Well, try it. You'll like it, okay? All right. Now the boxes. Good news and great joy, right? We've got, we want to send this out to the kids. I had a delivery driver yesterday that he knew that there were toys in the package because he could see in a bag. And the delivery driver said, I didn't think this was yours. And we said, well, let me tell you why. We have toys. And I told him all about this great ministry where we pack shoe boxes. This is not a box, it's flat, but you fold it into a box, right? We pack shoe boxes with candy, not chocolate, candy, toys, no candy, not even sweet, no sweets at all?
No toothpaste.
Thank you. I have no idea. That's changed, okay. Well, Teresa, we've got a lot of candy to hand out for Halloween. So, look, it's really for the kids to get these things. They get tons of kids when they get going overseas. They hear the gospel. They hear about Jesus. People know Jesus through this. You can be a part of this ministry by packing a shoebox. And listen, if you want to pack the shoebox and to give the $10 for this, it's a blessing for you. It's a blessing for us. And include in there a letter, even a card that would personalize it. That's fine. We plan on doing that, okay? There are boxes available. If you've signed up for this already, the boxes are available for you. Pick it up at the Welcome Center on the way out. Now, what if you haven't signed up for it? Well, you can go and sign up for it and get a box. Hey, what a deal that is, right? And so Jerry's going to be standing there all big grins because he is being a good husband, and Diana is going to be so proud of him because he's handing out all these boxes to so many people. Amen? All right. So we're going to do that. Is that it? That's it. Praise God for that. Where are you at, Crystal? I'm going to have you pray for us as we finish out our time. And what a great song selection this today, right? Amen. Good song selection. Praise God for that. I'll be at the door. Come and say hi. And I'll see you Wednesday night or on Sunday, okay? God bless us. Pray.
Dear Lord, thank you for the beautiful day and the weather that you've given us to enjoy. Thank you for allowing us to come to your church today to worship and the freedom to do so. And we also want to help us to remind us, give us faith over our fear when we're struggling with things, and help us to keep our eyes on you instead of our circumstances. And we pray that you be with us this week and guide us and direct us.